Okay, let's talk DNS records. There's a bunch of different types of records. We're not going to talk about all the different types of records because I think we'd be working on that for hours, but we'll talk about some of the major ones, some of the main types of DNS records that are most often used, including the ones that you see in front of you. So first up, the A records, also known as the host records. What these ones do is convert a host name like Schetzler.net or Google.com into an IP address. These are the meat of DNS. They convert words that humans can read more easily into numbers, IP addresses that computers read. There's two different kinds of host records. There's A and there's 4A. The A records are for IPv4, which is eventually going to be phased out, but it's still very much widely used today. And an IPv4 address, for example, 208.94. 116.204. That is the IP address of my server, my website, and that is an A record. And 4A are for IPv6, the newest version of the Internet Protocol. And addresses for that, as you can see, are significantly longer than IPv4 addresses. And so DNS is going to be even more important than it is today. If you thought it was hard to remember an IPv4 address, just take a look at an IPv6 address and try and memorize one of those, much less a stack of them. So at the bottom here, throughout these slides, I'm going to have examples from my own website, from my own DNS. And this here is an example of an A record. So all it says is Schetzler.net, my domain name, A, the type of record that it is, and then the IP address, which is the data that the A record returns. Next up is a CNAME or an alias. Now, what these do is direct one name to another name. So it allows you to give your server two different names. If you want to use it for two different things, you might want to give it two different names and have one name direct to the other. For example, you could direct gmail.com to mail.google.com so that you can automatically have everything on mail.google.com. Keep the servers, keep the A records for mail.google.com updated, and gmail.com just points to that. And in DNS, this results in another query because if I'm a system and I request gmail.com, for example, then I get back the response that says what you're really looking for is mail.google.com. And so now I have to send out another request for that A record for mail.google.com. And hopefully I can get the server, the IP address back from that. And this has the benefit that when you move mail.google.com to a new place, you only have to update one set of those A records. And down below, I'm on what's called a shared host. So my website is not the only site on that server. And so in order for that to work, I have a CNAME for www.schetzler.net to this drschetzler.nfshost.com, which is my hosting services server. And that means that they can move my website between servers and only have to update drschetzler.nfshost.com, and I never have to update anything. So as they're moving me around inside their data center, I don't have to change my record of www.schetzler.net. So a big one, a major type of record is MX, mail exchangers. These are huge. And what they allow me to do is have my website, my A records for my website at Schetzler.net pointing to my web server, and my MX records for Schetzler.net pointing to my mail server. In this case, I use Gmail. I use Google Apps to manage email for my domain. So if you send an email to me at Schetzler.net, that's going through Gmail. And these MX records that you see all point to gmail.com. And there's extra information in an MX record. That number that you see at the beginning is a priority. So with a higher priority or a lower number, that's the servers that are going to get tried first. And then as you move down the stack, if the first server goes down, we have backups. And this provides redundancy in case mail servers, one specific mail server goes down. Next up is NS records. Name server records, these, as is kind of obvious, direct to the name servers. And They're where you go if you need to know about a subdomain. So Schetzler.net, the two NS records, the two name servers for Schetzler.net are those two that are listed here. And I have, again, redundancy. So if one of those name servers goes down, I'm not out of luck and people can still get to Schetzler.net, can still find out domains. And what these tell you is where you want to go if you have to ask about a subdomain. For example, www.schetzler.net, blog.schetzler.net, home.schetzler.net. I can have whatever subdomains I want, and these NS records tell you where to go to find out the A records for those subdomains. And these NS records are actually listed in the .net top-level domain name servers. And if you look up Schetzler.net in the .net top-level domain, you're going to find references to these two name servers that I have. Next up, text records, TXT. This is for putting all sorts of stuff. And you can have TXT records for basically anything you want, including just funny sayings if for some reason you have the desire to do that. One of the major reasons that they are used is to verify ownership of a domain. For example, for Google Webmaster Tools and things like that, I need to be able to verify that I own the domain so that Google will give me information about it, how people get there, what searches people are using to get there and things. And I put up a TXT record with a big old random string that they asked for or that they specify. And I put that in a TXT record on my domain. And that proves to Google that I control that domain and that I own it. And the same with Keybase, a site for generating and managing private key authentication. They do the same thing. I can verify that I own Schetzler.net using a TXT record on that domain. Next up, we've got SRV records. These are service records, and they're kind of newer. And they do a lot of the same things that an MX record does. And in fact, if SRV records had been in wider adoption, we wouldn't have needed MX records to specify special servers for email. Because what they allow you to do is specify a service and a port, along with some other information like time to live and class and priority. Priority like we saw for the existing MX records. And what this does, if you could see the first record there, is HTTP, and that's the service. And then TCP is the transport layer protocol that's used. So you can specify different ones for HTTP, UDP, if for some reason you wanted to do that. And then some other information there, that time to live, the type of record that it is, and port 80 in this case for HTTP. And so you see port 80 there, and you point that to your alias or your A record for www.example.com. So this says that if someone requests port 80 HTTP on TCP, then we can send them to example.com. If someone requests this for SMTP, TCP on port 25, then we would send them to mail.example.com, and you could have a separate A record for mail.example.com there. And that would perform the same function as an MX record without having to create a special type of record. These service records are much more generalized, and you can use them for basically anything. So last thing, there's a whole bunch of different DNS record types. Like I said, if we can click this link, we'll pull up the big old list and see lots of them for IPsec, for keys, for DNSSEC. Lots of different types of records for different things. And we've already talked about the main ones, the A, the CNAME, the MX, the SRV, the TXT, and the NS records. And those are the most often used of the DNS records. The others are there, but they're not nearly as commonly used.